The house of the Lord tonight. Amen. The Lord is good. Welcome to the Wednesday night service at Okoye Church of God. We believe in the Lord for great things tonight. Let's stand and invite the Lord's presence into the service tonight. Hallelujah. Father God, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we just worship you. We praise you. We love you. We thank you again for the privilege and opportunity we have to come to worship you in the middle of this week, Lord. We come to magnify you and glorify you, Lord. For, Lord, you are worthy to be praised. You are worthy to be worshipped. You are worthy to be adored, Lord. Father, Lord, we come before your presence with thanksgiving. We enter to your courts with praise. Father, Lord, we invite your presence. We ask that thy perfect will to be done. Father, Lord, just saturate this place with your presence. Meet every need in the congregation, Lord, every need in every situation. We ask, Lord, that thy perfect will to be done, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Remain standing and let's worship the Lord tonight.
This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made, that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day that the Lord has made. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him, heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve. What a righteous God we serve. What a righteous God we serve. The angels bow before him, heaven and earth adore him. What a righteous God we serve. And what a loving God we serve. What a loving God we serve. The angels bow before him, heaven and earth adore him. What a loving God we serve. Oh, what a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. The angels bow before him, heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve. Oh, what a holy God we serve. What a holy God we serve. The angels bow before him, heaven and earth adore him. What a holy God we serve. What a faithful God we serve. What a faithful God we serve. The angels bow before him, heaven and earth adore him. What a faithful God we serve. Oh, what an awesome God we serve. What an awesome God we serve. Wash me in your cleansing flow. Now all I know is your forgiveness and embrace. Worthy is the Lamb seated on the throne. We crown you now with for the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame, in love you came and gave amazing grace. Thank you for this love, Lord. Thank you for the wash me in your cleansing flow. Now all I know is your forgiveness and embrace. Worthy is the Lamb seated on the throne. We crown you with many crowns, you reign victorious. You're high and lifted up, Jesus, Son of God, the darling.
Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. It's good to have each and every one of you here tonight. Let's go over the announcements with you real fast. Amen. Don't forget our Easter events coming up. It's be here before you know it. A week from Friday will be our Good Friday service at 7 o'clock here in the sanctuary. We're believing the Lord for a great day that day as we celebrate the crucifixion of Jesus. And then Saturday we're having the extravaganza, the egg run and the egg hunt. And then Sunday morning we're having a 9 o'clock and 11 o'clock service. Please do not forget to fill out your little thing on here. Let us know what service you plan on coming to. And if you're, does it matter to you, put no preference in so we can decide which service we need you to come to. Depends on the attendance wise. So if you could please fill that out for us and put it in the offering or give it to Sister Christy in the back or something that would just help us so we know who's coming to what service. Don't forget our pre-filled Easter eggs this year. And we're not having you to bring in eggs, candy this year. But if you would like to make a donation toward the pre-filled eggs, they're here already. Just welcome to make a donation. Pastor began the sermon series, The Transforming Gospel. Talking about Jesus Christ transforms our heart and our life. Women's Bible study, don't forget, is this Thursday. Tomorrow night at 7 o'clock, they're continuing the Bible study on the 12 women of the Bible. So don't forget, we've changed it a little this month. It will be this coming Thursday, tomorrow at 7 o'clock. And Love My Shirts, remember to get your Love My Shirts shirts because we're having the a Love My Shirt t-shirt night the end of the month. So make sure that you hurry up and get your shirt. Don't forget, this Sunday night we're having the light showcase. Will be this Sunday, the 9th. Yeah, that's this Sunday. It was 7 o'clock LCA showcase. It's what? Sunday night, right? 6 o'clock. Yeah, the 9th at 6 o'clock. Don't forget that. Come, the kids, the youth. That are doing some of the different things that they're doing. Some of them's doing poetry. Some of them is doing, a couple's doing preachings. They're doing some singing. Got a choir singing. And so all of these and some of our projects will be on display here. Science projects, art projects, photography. So it's just a way to get them, kind of a get them ready for the event. So we look forward to that this Sunday night. Okay, a junior praise team and junior ushers, if you would come on up. Don't forget, Saturday we do have youth choir practice at 6 o'clock. And we do have the drama practice at 7 o'clock. I like our junior ushers tonight. The junior boy club. Junior boys. Amen. Let's bow our heads for prayer tonight. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for the opportunity we have to give today, Lord, as we bring your tithes and our offering to you today. We pray, Lord, that you bless it richly and abundantly, God. As the saints of God give, Lord, I pray that you bless them financially, you bless them spiritually, physically, every area of their hearts and their life. Give them back into them, pressed down, shaken together. Lord, supply every one of their needs. And Lord, we pray that you meet every need of the church today. You know every need and you know every circumstance. And Lord, you're able to supply everyone. And Father God, we give you the thanks and the praise and the glory. Lord, in Jesus' wonderful name we pray. Amen.
Great is our God. Sing with me how great is our God. Oh, sing how great is our God. How great is our God. Sing with me how great our God, oh.
Amen. I forgot one announcement that I need to make. Brother Roger needs to meet with all of our choir to get ready for Easter. So all of those that sing in the choir, and maybe you don't sing in the choir, we want to have practice with our youth this Saturday before they have youth choir practice. So at 5:30, we would like our adults, all the adults that usually sing in the choir, and some of you that don't sing in the choir, you're welcome to come help us with that. We'll go over the songs that we're planning on doing for Easter. So if you could be here this Saturday at 5:30, and the youth is supposed to be here at 5:30 also, so we could have practice with them a little early with the choir, and from 5:30 to 6, and then 6 o'clock they'll have their regular youth practice. So we need everyone, the youth and the children's choir, here at 5:30, and adults be here at 5:30 so we can go over some songs with Brother Roger that we're going to do for Easter. That will be for the both services on Sunday morning. Okay, don't forget today, we are still in the modulars. So as the boys club and girls club go out, remember to go back in the back to the rooms that you usually go to. So the boys club and girls club and the little kids can all be dismissed. Remember to walk. Don't run, don't hop, don't skip. Go to the Lord in prayer tonight for our prayer request. Sister Margaret Calvert called in the office today. Wanted to remember her in prayer that she is sick, and also she wanted to remember a friend of hers, Maisie Allen, is having knee replacement. So she requests to remember both of these in prayer, Margaret Calvert and then Maxie Allen. Amen. Any prayer request on my right side that we need to remember? Brother Roger. Yes, let's remember her in prayer. Sister Edna? Oh, wow. Yes. Remember Sister Butts in prayer. Sister Sonia. Okay. Okay. And Brother Ashbury. Okay. To remember Sister Ashbury in prayer. Amen. Sister Donna? Traveling Mercy, you leaving again? Going back up north? Key West. Okay. Hey, that's Sister Helen, not Sister Donna. Sorry about that. Amen. Any others on this side? Sister Leslie. Thank you. Amen. Any others on this side? Sister Tammy. Oh. Yes, let's remember this in prayer. Pastor? Okay. Okay. Just remember this. Any others on this side? Nessie, you got another one? Yes, remember Sister Marisol. I think they're having visitation tonight and funeral tomorrow, right? Her brother, 51 years old, had an aneurysm and died in New York, Thursday, I think it was. He passed away before she was able to get up there. So let's just be praying for this family. That's our teacher, one of our teachers here. And her and her husband pastor our Spanish church right down the road. So let's just remember them in prayer. Let's remember Sister Lily in prayer. I don't see Sister Lily here tonight, so. Okay. Uh-huh. Okay. Amen. Any on my left side? Okay. Amen. Any others on this side? Amen. Any others? Just remember all of our unsaved loved ones. Continue to pray for the church. Remember the pray, invite, grow. Continue to pray for, remember on the list here, your prayer requests. If there's divided out A through F, you pray for the first column. I think it's, it's in the other thing there. G through P, I think, prays for the middle column, and the rest of it, pray for the last column. Let's remember to pray, and then let's remember to invite. As we look in Gary for Easter, give out the invite cards and the postcards that we have. Amen. Let us stand and just take these knees to the Lord in prayer tonight. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you. Lord, we praise you. We love you. We adore you tonight. Father, Lord, for thou art worthy to be praised. Lord, thou art worthy to be worshipped. Thou art worthy to be adored, Lord. We give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor. We pray for each one of these requests tonight, Lord. You know each and every one of these needs. You know each and every one of these requests tonight, Lord. Father, Lord, just touch and minister, Lord. Father, Lord, we thank you for this report for Sister Sonia's dad, Lord. Father, Lord, we believe in you that you completely heal him and touch him. Father, Lord, in the name of Jesus, we pray for Miss Marisol. Father, Lord, for the loss of her brother, Lord, 51 years old, Lord. Father, Lord, they have visitation tonight and service up tomorrow up in New York, Lord. I just pray that you be with them and comfort and strengthen them this time of need, Lord. Father, Lord, we pray for Brother Roger's mom, Lord, that you would just meet this need as she has this cold or flu. Father, Lord, you're able to touch her and minister to her. Father, Lord, we pray for Sister Butts, Lord, that you would touch Keith's mom that had this procedure done, Lord. Father, Lord, just let your complete healing power to flow, Lord. Father, Lord, we pray for Sister Helen as she travels down to Key West, Lord, that you would give her traveling mercies, Lord. Father, Lord, give her a safe trip there and safe trip back with no problems or no difficulties. Father, Lord, touch Sister Ashbury today, Lord. Continue to let your healing power to flow, Lord. Touch Sister Lily, Lord, that you would minister to her and touch her, Lord. Father God, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Father, Lord, we praise you, Lord. We pray for Pastor Renfro's request that he mentioned, Lord. Father, Lord, with Brother Ben's family, Lord, you see this need and you see this situation, Lord. Lord, you're able to just touch and minister, Lord. We pray for Sister Sonia's family that you would continue to meet their needs. every need in our heart and every need in our life today, Lord. Father God, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, every need and every situation tonight, Lord. Yes, Lord, we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Father, Lord, we praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. Lord, in the name of Jesus, we worship you, Lord. For thou art worthy to be praised and worshiped and adored, Lord. Father, Lord, we pray for our Easter event that's coming up. Father, Lord, as we pray and we invite, we're believing for growth, Lord. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for hearing our prayers. We thank you for answering them. And Lord, we give you the thanks and the praise and the glory, Lord. In Jesus' wonderful name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Before you're seated, let's just sing this. Things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Oh, turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Amen. You can be seated tonight in the house of the Lord. So good to have you with us tonight. I trust Pastor Ricky greeted you and shared announcements with you. Did you share about women's Bible study tomorrow night? All right, if not, I'll get in trouble. And choir practice 5:30 on Saturday. They're going to just pull you together and sing a little bit with the kids before they start their choir practice. So be with us Saturday night at 5:30. Thank you, Pastor, for doing that. And don't forget to turn in your little response card, 9 or 11, for Easter Sunday. I trust he mentioned that as well. I've been here. I'm not running late. I got stopped on the way to the sanctuary and just getting in. But I'm ready. God's ready. God's good. Can you say amen? Let me just change the gears in my brain just for a moment, and I will be ready to do that. When you come back to the piano, when we close, if you'll play that song we were talking about earlier, I Need Thee, Oh, I Need Thee, okay? And that will help me as I close out tonight. All right. Let's go to the book of Mark chapter number 16 tonight. Where we'll take our text from. You can remain seated for the reading of God's Word. It's been a hot day. Can somebody say amen? And I guess it's going to get a cold front coming through, some rain. It's going to be cold Friday, I guess it is. So they can't make up their mind if we're going to be hot or cold. I've just decided to go with the flow. Whatever it is. Can you say amen? Because we can't change it anyhow. So we might as well just like it. And I was at lunch today and... just a unique situation. I went to grab a quick bite of lunch before an appointment that I had here. And the guy sitting across the table, I didn't know the guy. Mark chapter 16 is where we're headed. And the guy across the table, I didn't know him. And I really didn't have a whole lot of time to chit-chat. I was trying to eat and leave. I didn't want to be rude, but I didn't want to chat. Because if I got started, I was going to be late. And he mentioned the weather and how hot it was. And I just said, yes, sir, it's quite warm. And summer's probably going to be unbearable, and left it at that because I had things to do. And then out of the blue he said, do you ever tie your ties with different knots than what you have there now? I'm thinking, what does it matter how I tie my tie? And then he went in this long story about how he likes this knot versus that knot, and his son wears a tie every Friday to school, and he likes this knot. I'm thinking, I really don't care what knot you like. I'm trying not to be rude. I'm trying to eat my lunch. I'm trying to get out of there. And as I'm inhaling my food and trying to be polite, I finally got, not finished, but enough that I was done, and picked my stuff up and said, it was so great to speak with you today. Have a great afternoon. That was just a little bit weird for me today. And I don't usually care how you tie, Pastor Ricky. I don't care how you tie your tie. Just if you're going to wear one, make sure. Then he got off on bow ties. He said, I don't like them. And I said, well, I have a few. My son wears them. How old's your son? And I think he was just a worker who was lonely and wanted to chat. And they go to church over in Altamont Springs. Been there 22 years. And you got a 15-year. I know more about this guy than he ever knows about me. And I don't know if he liked my knot on my tie or not. I really don't care, but I don't know if he liked it or not. So that was kind of my lunch today. So I'm not sure how your lunch was. It makes me not want to go out to eat by myself anymore. Cause and I knew I shouldn't have sat in that. I could have sat on the other side of the table and he would have saw my back. And I thought, well, I didn't want to be rude. You know, you don't want to sit right in front of somebody and you're back at. So I thought, well, I'll sit here. And no more of that. If I'm in a hurry, they'll just have my back. So that's the way it'll go. If you're at Mark 16, say amen. Amen. Now let me just fix this tie. Now that I've mentioned all that, let me just go ahead and unbutton it and give me a little bit of breathing room here. I started this last Wednesday night. I have gnawed on it some more. And some of you sent messages or a text or two and just said thank you. It helped you kind of just to keep things in perspective. And if you'll allow me for the next, I don't know, 20, 30 minutes or so, I'm going to try to finish this. And then I want us to, when I've asked Wendy to come back and play that song, I Need Thee, Oh, I Need Thee. And I want us to come, and we're going to probably close in standing around this altar as a family, because what I am learning in this time, this season of my life in ministry is that there are no long rangers. Can you say amen? We are a family. We do things together. And we need to absolutely get under the mission, get under the call, get under the burden that God has given us, and do our part. And whatever our part is all that we are expected to do. And if I'll do my part, and Ricky does his part, and Brother Roger does his part, collectively, the church as a whole will do their part. And I'm just saying, Lord, I want to make sure I always take time to keep the main thing the main thing. Can somebody say amen for that? And that's kind of where I started last week. I'm going to read those two verses again. I'm going to just give you the bullet points from last week and then get into the new ones this week, because I've had to live some of this week. And that's just the way it goes. When you preach it, either you've just came out of it or you're probably getting ready to go in it. I've seen it time and time again, and I've had to live it. So Mark 16, verses 15 and 16. And he said unto them, Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. For a little while tonight, I'm going to continue on this thought, the church's mission. And I'm going to ask you just to pray with me that God will anoint me to deliver what's before us. Father, we love you tonight. Thank you, Lord, for the time we've had in worship. Thank you for the ministry that's happening across this campus right now as we speak. And Father, I pray for every club. I pray for every class. I pray that you'll just anoint them in their area of ministry to do what needs to be done. Lord, I pray for the adults that are in this sanctuary tonight. I pray that we will open up your Bible, that we will learn together. Father, that we will be encouraged, that we will be strengthened. Lord, that we will be reminded of the importance of following after the words of Christ and doing what Christ has called us to do, Lord. And I will forever be grateful for it. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Everybody said amen and amen. Last week, I began this thought on the church's mission, and I told us that missions was the heartbeat of God. You've heard that. If you've been in church any time at all, you probably have heard messages on that or that thought said. Number two last week is I told us that missions is the pouring out of the soul of our Savior, and we do that in two ways. We pour out our soul in service and in death to the rescuing of those that are perishing. That we need to be so full of the cause of Christ, and we need to be so full of what God is doing in our life that we're ready to do anything we can for service unto the Lord. We need to be a doorkeeper. We need to be an usher. We need to be one that will clean up the yard. We need to do whatever we can in the service for the Lord to be ready to share the gospel message of our Savior. And that includes all the way to death. Now, some folks will go with you as long as it doesn't cost them anything. But when it starts costing people something, you lose a lot of friends if you're not careful. And I want us to realize that Jesus wanted nothing earthly, no gold, no position, no fame. And what he wanted to do was to drink of the cup, the bitter cup that was put before him, that the will of the Father could be accomplished. And I ended that part last week asking you a question. What are we willing to pour out of our lives so that somebody else could be saved? And sometimes that's not easily answered. Sometimes that answer is a tough answer, but I did challenge you with that. And then thirdly, last week, the last point I got to last week was missions is the marching order of the church. Our text tells us that Jesus said unto them, "Go ye into all the world." And then I read other examples of marching commands or of instructions that we were given by the Word of God to go and to disciple the world in which we live. And then I likened it to Elijah and Elisha. We likened it into Pentecost. We talked about all of that. And then I used this, read this quote that was available through studying. It says, if missions is the heartbeat of God, then no church or no person can be against missions or against missionaries without sinning toward or sinning against the heart of our Heavenly Father. If we ever come in contact with churches, if we ever come in contact with individuals that say, I'm not for missions, I'm not for missionaries, and I'm not for discipleship, then what they're saying is that they are directly against what God has called us to do, because it is the words of Christ that says we are to go out into the world making disciples of them, to preach and to teach. And so I want us to keep the perspective, because it's not about our buildings, it's not about our programs, it's about taking what we've got and giving it to somebody else. And sometimes that is better done outside the four walls of the church. I'm thankful for every visitor. I'm thankful for every newcomer, those that come and stay, I'm even more thankful for. But sometimes we can reach more people outside of these four walls than we ever will inside of these four walls. And we see that directly evident in mission crusades and missions events, maybe outside of our own country. I love America. I still believe it's the best country in the world. I'm thankful for padded pews and air conditioning. But sometimes, I'll just be honest with you, I think it's made us lazy in a lot of areas, not just in church. Can anybody witness with me tonight and say amen? And I'm not saying I'm against all of it. I don't want to go back to pews that would boarded pews and no air conditioning. I hear those stories. I don't want to go there, but I want to be careful that we don't get asleep or we get relaxed in the mission that God's called us to do. So that was last week. Tonight, number four, missions is the theme of the Bible. Somebody asked me today, well, what is the theme of this year for your church? Or if you give me one word, and I looked at this individual, I said, pig. Before I said pig, I said, pray, invite, grow, and we have called that behind the scenes pig. He chuckled with me and laughed at me, and I said, what it is to get us thinking about everything that we do. Does it give an opportunity for somebody to find their way to Christ? The Bible is a missionary book. To the student of missions, the Bible is their textbook. What is a textbook? All of you have had days in school, a math book, an English book, a science book, and that book is what you studied out of that year. That book is where you have gained knowledge from. That book was where you went to seek answers. And for the student that is a missionary, a student of missions, the Bible is the textbook of missions. It is an opportunity for them to open up and see how others have done it, to learn from their example, to learn from their ways, to learn from the Word of God. It is their textbook. And for the missionary, once they have moved from a student of missions to a missionary, the Bible is their handbook. Textbook to handbook. What is a handbook? Well, if you are employed, no doubt you have an employee handbook. If you go to the hospital, they're going to give you something called a patient's responsibility. It's what you can and cannot do. If you have a student in any school system at all, they're going to have a handbook, a student handbook, a parent handbook. It's kind of, okay, here's how we're going to operate. Here's what we're going to do. Here's how it's going to work. And to a missionary, the Bible should be their handbook. When I don't know what to do, I'm going to open the handbook and find out. For those that have been in the Church of God a long time, you know that we every 2 years have a General Assembly, and we perfect and we change and we alter the things called the minutes of the Church of God. Next to the Bible, after the Bible, we'll go to the minutes. The minutes are our handbook. The minutes just tells us how we... So we understand this concept of a handbook, and to a missionary, it is supposed to be the Bible. No man can consciously stand on the Bible and declare that they are against missions. Because from the very beginning of this, we see God was interested in helping to save somebody. Now let's back up just a moment in this point, and let's talk about Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve sinned. I don't care how you want to slice it. I don't care what you want to say about it. They went against the will of God. Before that time, God would come down in the cool of the day and commune with them. And does not the handbook tell us that after they had sinned and after God knew what they had done, did not God still come down and say, and I'll paraphrase, Adam, where are you? God wasn't asking where Adam was because God didn't know where he was. God was asking because all the way back from the book of Genesis, if you will, we see it has been God's desire to have a relationship with man. He has now, because of the move of the Spirit and the men of old, we now have the Word of God that we can apply to our heart. And I'm thankful for the handbook that He has given us. But let us not think that this come about only as a New Testament thing. No, the Scriptures of old give us indication that God still had a desire to go after and to teach and to disciple and to be involved in reconciling man back with God. That was the Old Testament. In the New Testament, missions is the central theme of everything that happens in that New Testament. Everything. Now my notes say it like this: not politics, to which I say praise the Lord. Not policies, to which I also say praise the Lord. And not programs, which I will be redundant one more time and say, praise the Lord. Why? Because politics, policies, and programs will always carry the flavor of man. It'll be their spin on it. Their spin on the program, their spin on the policy, their spin on the politics. But when we get above the three P's and we go back to the handbook, we will find what God's take is on it. And I said, Lord, let us be a church that realizes that missions is the theme of the Bible. And when we go to look for a New Year theme, we go to look for a theme for our family, a theme for our church, and let us not get too far out of the book, because the book should be our handbook for Christian day living. I thought about that. Christ was a missionary. Think about it. Christ was a missionary. Will you allow me to define the word missionary very loosely? Someone who goes to a place that they're not from, and spiritually speaking, with the intent of leading them to Christ. That's a very loose, fluid definition of missionary, but I think it'll work. If I use that definition, then absolutely Christ was a missionary. He left his home above, came to a world who rejected him, but said, anyhow, I will go and do what needs to be done to give a way of reconciliation. Christ was a missionary. Paul was a missionary. Paul was something else. The study of Paul at times is just, it just baffles me. This is the same guy who used to be Saul. This is the same guy who thought he was doing what he was doing was right. Had letters from headquarters, I'm going to, and in that situation, Christ, the Lord, our Heavenly Father, got a hold of his number and changed the dynamics of Paul's life for the rest of the time that we read about him. And Paul was a missionary helping somebody find Jesus as their Savior. Jesus was a missionary. Paul was a missionary. The four Gospels are missionary books. Now, I will confess, I've never thought of them like that. I've thought of them as the Gospels, the Matthew, Mark, the Luke, and John. We call them the Gospels. But if you will allow me, they are each a missionary book. When somebody asks you, you got a good missionary book to read? Tell them, hey, go and find the book of Mark and just read it today. Because in each of these Gospels, we can see that missionary concept, that theme of bringing folks to Christ, available in every one of those books. The Acts of the Apostles are the acts of the Holy Ghost alive and moving forward with the mission spirit. Now, I love the book of Acts. And if you are Pentecostal, you believe in the book of Acts. But let's remember what the book of Acts said. It is the Acts of the Apostle. It is those that were in that upper room that came down and turned the world upside down. They were missionaries. I think it was Sunday that I mentioned things like those that have spread their doctrine in other places that have come here also. And I made a statement about anytime that we see that New Testament church going somewhere, there was either a revolution or a riot. Why? Because if this is our handbook, then everything that we do should be spent trying to bring people into a right relationship with the handbook that they're going to be held accountable to. And so everywhere that New Testament church went, there was differences made. Begin to think about the concept of where we're at. The world justifies missions. Well, you know, we're doing this over there, and isn't that nice they're doing that over there, and I'm not making light of that at all. Had an individual in my office today, and he was sharing some things with me about some projects that are upcoming in our church, and I wanted just to talk to someone and just needed to gain some knowledge, and I'm not sure how much knowledge today I gained, but I'm still working. I'm working with him. I'm trying to learn, and he was been talking about, you know, taking this and the number of people in other countries that need to be fed and the mission work. I said, yes, it's all important, but let me be reminded that missions does not have to be outside of Ocoee. The theme book of this word still is effective to those that live right across the street. It's the theme. It's the marching orders. It is the theme of the Word of God. Paul was a missionary. Christ was a missionary. The four Gospels are missionary books. The Acts of the Apostles give us those examples of missionary. Acts 1 and 8 teaches that what Christ began, the disciples and the Holy Ghost are to continue. Okay, so if Christ was a missionary, and I believe we can say that without stretching Scripture at all, and Acts 1 and 8 tells us that what Christ began, we should continue, and you probably could quote Acts 1 and 8 as probably I could, but we're just going to make sure that we read it correctly. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be, what's that word? Witnesses unto me in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost part of the earth. If that is the word of the Lord recorded in Acts chapter 1, then what Christ began, we are to continue, and we will only do that successfully when we keep the theme of the Bible. And that's missions. Let me move on. A Bible church must be a missionary church. From Genesis to Revelations, missions is the theme. Those who deny the Bible, okay, are no worse than those who neglect the heart of God, which is missions. Now that's a strong, I read that one last week. I didn't share that with you last week. Those, and we all know those people that are not willing to be with the Lord, and they're rank stank sinners. Okay, you understand that language? I'm from Stark. But they're no more of a sinner than the one that does not understand the theme of the Bible is missions. Because I've already said you can't be Christian and be against missions or the mission concept. So if I'm against the mission, if I'm against missions and I'm against the mission concept, I'm against what the Word of God says I should be for, that means I'm going against the Word of God. That's the same thing as being in the terminology I used, a rank, stink, sinner. We need to be very careful that we don't miss the theme of the Bible. Now let me go back to those three P's just for a moment before I leave this area. Politics, policies, programs. Politics. In anything that people are involved in, good, bad, or indifferent, there's hopefully some order and structure, and we can liken that to politics. Okay? In anything that men and women are involved in, I hope there are some policies. If not, you're going to have a mess on your hands. There has to be a right way of doing things. And then with anything that you're involved in, whether it be your job or your home or your free time, there's a program, there's a method, there's a way of doing that. And the church as well, there's programs even inside of our church. So I don't want you to leave and have the understanding that, oh, we're just going to throw everything out and we're just going to be theme only. No, there has to be structure, decency, and in order. But it cannot be the theme of what we do. The theme has to be missions. The theme has to be, let me find out what God has called us collectively to do and us individually to do, and let's do it until the day Jesus calls us home. The theme of missions. We're not going to find a new book. We're going to use the book we've already been given, the Word of Lord. Number five tonight. Missions is the gathering in of the earth's golden harvest. The gathering in of the earth's golden harvest. Let me share with you a little bit about this harvest. Some reap in abundance like Boaz. Some glean like Ruth. Some have extra ability and they use it effectively. We would liken them to the individual with the five talents in Matthew 25. Others only have one talent, and unfortunately they've buried it, like Matthew 25 and 18 tells us. Some are able to give more time to prayer, while others are able to give more money. Some are able to give special skills, but all are able to give their time to missions work. Does not matter where you've come from. Does not matter what talents God's blessed you with. Does not matter how many zeros are in your checkbook. Does not matter when it comes to the theme of this book. The theme of this book is missions, and each of us have the ability to use our time for missions. And in supporting missions, there are many new converts won to Christ in foreign countries because somebody would simply go and take a risk and share with them their story. It amazes me what people do. I would say probably even in our world at some point in our country, but it amazes me what happens in these distant lands, and they don't have the programs and policies and policies and politics that we do. They simply have somebody willing to open up their mouth and just share the gospel message. I say, God, can we get back to some of that simplicity? Can we get back to let's not make this thing real difficult. I'm thankful for education, formal education, but I really don't care how many letters are behind your name. What I want you to tell me is that Jesus loves me, and if I don't have Jesus in my heart, I'm going to die and go to hell. But if I will accept Jesus as my Savior and repent of my sins, I can spend eternity with Him in heaven. It's simple. It's missions. And we've got to make sure we keep it as the theme. Missions is that gathering in. Psalms 125, verses 5 and 6. They that sow in tears shall reap in joy. He that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him. There is seasons in our life. I am learning that more and more and more as I age and as my family grows. And I say, God, whatever season I am in, I don't want to lose the theme of your word. And that is, let me help somebody find Jesus. Now, can I share my heart with you about my lunch event today? I'm going to be honest. God knew my schedule. I knew my schedule. And what I have thought about after leaving that lunch event today was I where I was at to do the mission of God, and did I miss an opportunity? Now, I'm not, as of yet, and my day slows down tonight, God may deal with me differently. As of now, I don't believe I did. I don't feel that way. But if this is truly the theme of my life, then was that an opportunity? Because have we not prayed for this opportunities to come this week? Did I not, as your leader, stand in this pulpit Sunday and ask God to give us those appointments? Did I do that? And because of a schedule, because of policies, programs, and politics, did I miss an opportunity to do the mission of God? I guess if I did, God will convict me of that. I trust I didn't. But it's just that quick that we'll miss it. It's just that quick that somebody will come across our path. And if we're not thinking on everything that we do with a heavenly mindset as gathering in the earth's golden harvest, we might miss an opportunity. Why? Because there is plenty of work to be done. The harvest truly is plenteous. Reading from Matthew chapter 9, pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send what? Laborers. Laborers. It says there's plenty of work. There's plenty of harvest. We need more laborers. What does the Bible not tell us? It does not tell us that we have plenty of time. Let me read from John chapter 4. Say ye not that there are yet 4 months and then cometh harvest. Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes, look on the fields, for they are white already to harvest. I'm being totally transparent with you. In a rush to get to an appointment, did I miss what I've spent 2 weeks preaching to you on? And if I did, then how many have you missed? If I did, and I knew what I was preaching tonight, I knew what I was going to teach on, I knew the scriptures we was going to face tonight, and if I missed it, and I'm no better than you are, we probably have all missed it. And I said, God, let me make the theme of my life to help somebody find Jesus as their Savior. Can somebody just say amen? Let me move on. Soon the doors will close. Pulling from Proverbs chapter 10, woe to the one who sleeps in the time of harvest. Because according to Proverbs, he that sleepeth in harvest is a son that causeth shame. God, I don't want to be a son of shame. God, I don't want to bring reproach and disgrace and things of that nature to your name. Let me be busy. Not busy to be busy, but let me be busy doing the theme, the mission of the church. Number 6 and lastly. Missions is man's work finished and the heart of God satisfied. There will be an end to this life. Some days, take me now, Lord Jesus. Other days, we're trucking along pretty good. There will be an end of this life of toil, this life of sickness, this life of battles. There will be an end. Some will die in situations like men of old that we have read, a martyr's death. Others will be like John, and their life will be spared until a later event. We have no idea how we will end this life. Many of us are not chosen for the frontline battle. But if we are faithful where God puts us, the Word of God teaches us that we will receive His reward. The Lord will help me in the next week or two on Wednesday night. I'm going to preach about the crowns of a Christian. And there are some rewards that we're eligible for. But we've got to be faithful. Got to do what God's called us to do. And even if you're not on the front line of the battle, don't give in. Because what you do, although you may not think it's important, if it's what God's called you to do, it is the most important thing in your life. One day, when God's faithful stand at attention in heaven, when earth's role is being called and heavenly rewards and awards are being given, we will be glad that we gave Him our everything. Well, Pastor, my everything is not very much. Well, you're looking at what you're giving based on maybe what your neighbor's giving. But God's asking you to give Him your everything based on what you have. And I read where someone gave two mites and gave more than all the others gave. So don't get caught up in politics, policies, and programs, the three P's. Don't get caught up in that. It's important. It has a place. But let's find the mission of God. Let's find the heart of God. God, if there's ever a time we need Him, we need Him now. Where I can do the mission that God has called me to do. We may never receive a purple heart. We may never receive a bronze star. But ours will be a crown of glory that fadeth not away. According to 1 Peter chapter 5 and 4. Never fades away. I'm going to preach on those crowns if God will let me. Maybe on a Wednesday night about those crowns that we can receive. When God sees the finished work of His Son and sees the scars, the sweat, and the tears of the redeemed one, I truly am convinced that it will bring satisfaction to the heart of God. As difficult as it was for Him to see Jesus die on that cross, it was the perfect will of God. As difficult as it is on some things that you deal with in your life, if it is the will of God, there is no other place that you want to be. Pastor, it's just so hard sometimes. Oh, I know. I know. I told leadership group Monday night, I said, we're going to have this meeting, and I'm going home, and I'm eating, and I'm going to bed. It was just one of them days. I was being transparent with them. Yesterday was better. Today has been better. I trust if I live to see tomorrow, it'll be a good day. But you know what? It rains all day, and I don't like the weather, and it's too hot or too cold, and everybody's mad with me. You know what? I'm going to still have a God that loves me. And I'm going to try to find something that I can do to help somebody find Jesus. And the next time I go to McDonald's for lunch, I mean, God's going to have to pray that thing through tonight because I'm being serious. Now, I think he was saved. At least he knew about church. He knew about fellowship. But I wonder if that was a missed opportunity. And I said, God, I'm taking a risk tonight because I want you to know I'm no different than you are. I have to put into practice what I preach as well. And God, if I missed an opportunity, will you give me one more chance to help somebody else tomorrow? Mission of Christ. When God sees all this, I believe His heart will be satisfied. God's words to those who have helped reap the golden harvest will be that faithful word that scripture we find in Matthew 25. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord. That's what I'm longing for. Whatever I do here is not going to last. Whatever happens around this place, whatever happens with my family, whatever materialistic stuff that we have, it's not going to last. What I do for the kingdom will last for eternity. And I want to be mission-minded. Let me close with this. Come on, baby. God pity us if we build churches that are beautiful, if we build parsonages that are phenomenal, but forget missions. Jesus never said to build churches and build parsonages or anything else you want to say in there. But He did say, go ye into all the world, preach to every creature, teach all nations, and be a witness. I say, God, that's what I'm going to do tonight. I'm just going to be a witness. Just going to be a witness. And if some other guy, I don't think you heard the first part of that, but if some other guy wants to talk about the knot in my tie, it's awkward. I wouldn't have dared said that to somebody. Oh, he was very comfortable with it. Oh, and I also learned, when he takes his ties off, he don't put them back in the closet tied. They have to be untied and folded to put away. He says, because ain't nobody got time to be steaming no tie on Sunday morning. Boy told me. Now, I'll untie this knot when I get home, and I'll hang it back on that tie thing I have in the closet. But now before I put it back on again, it'll go by the ironing board and it'll be ironed to make sure those creep. So I don't do it exactly like he does it, but close. So when you're out this weekend, if some guy sits across you with a tie on, be careful. He might be watching you not. He might be wanting you to open a door up to talk to him about Jesus. Something as simple as that. And in my heart, I don't believe I missed the Lord. But I'm so serious about where we're at with the Lord that I don't want to discharge anything that happens in my day I want to be sensitive to the Spirit of God. Because it's the Lord's work. It's His work. And I'm not going to be able to do it all by myself, and neither can you, but I'm going to do my part, and Leslie will do her part, Sonia will do her part, Shirley will do her part, we'll each do our own parts, and when we do that, Brother Billy, God will give the increase. That's what I'm praying for. She's playing that old song, I Need Thee, Oh, I Need Thee. We practiced it this afternoon, found the right key, was ready to go, and we're going to sing it. And if we're going to do what God's called us to do, we're going to fight the devil. Folks are going to talk about us. Folks are going to make fun of us. Folks are going to lie on us. Folks are going to say things that ain't even more close. They're going to say things that they have turned around and misconstrued, and they might not even realize they've done it. I said, God, help me just to stay mission-minded. Help me keep the main thing. And Lord, let me be willing to send that lifeline out to somebody and help will them into Jesus if that's what I need to do. Because when everything's said and done, that's all that's going to matter, is where we stand with the Lord. Would you stand with me tonight? And if you can we come and just make a big circle around this altar? And I want us to pray as a family tonight, standing at the altar of the Lord. Can you sing that, I Need Thee, Oh, I Need Thee? And I may join you in a few moments. And I want us just to pray. Oh, bless me now, my Savior, I come to. Let's sing it one time. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior, I come to thee. Father, truly we need you as a church. We need you as families. God, let us be sensitive to your leading. Let us be busy about the mission work of Christ. Go with us from this place. Bring us back for the events of this week. Gather us back in this place on Sunday to lift up the name of Jesus. And we will forever be grateful for it. In his name we pray. Everybody said amen and amen. God bless you. Fellowship one with another. And I'll see you Sunday, if not before. God bless you. You are dismissed.